All right. How we doing this morning? Oh, I heard a little bit of enthusiasm. How we doing this morning? All right. First thing I want to do is, I guess, reintroduce myself. I'm Brian.
Hi, Brian.
I had someone come up to me about a week ago and say, "Hey, man, where you been? You still go to church here?" Yeah, I haven't been anywhere, and I realized every Sunday we're up in the youth building, and I don't get a chance to make it down here, so yes, I am still here, everyone, so don't have to ask, I'm here. What I kind of want to talk to you guys about a little bit today is, I kind of feel like I'm one of those delayed translation movies, because everything happened a couple weeks ago, but it's my first time to really talk to you about it, but it's been a great week, great couple weeks for the youth program, and one thing I really thought about is how can I describe it? And the first thing that really came to mind for me was a cherry tree. I mean, think about a cherry tree. A cherry tree grows big and tall, and it produces all these cherries that fall to the ground, and you think, man, what a waste. But it's really not. Humans come along, and we pick the cherries, and we eat them, and use them in our cakes, and pies and these high-fat products that we make. What humans don't pick fall to the ground and become food for animals to come along and eat. But something else happens when those cherries fall to the ground. They biodegrade and return as nutrients into the soil to feed the cherry tree. And that's something I saw a couple weeks ago at camp. Eagle's Way is a cherry tree, and our youth, we're the seeds that are falling to the ground and to eventually grow and feed ourselves, feed this tree. I really saw the future leaders of Eagle's Way Church as they really dug deep within themselves and connected with themselves and connected with God. I saw the people that are going to step up and really take this church to the next level. I mean, when you think about it, Pastor Buren's been preaching since the late 1800s. I mean, at some point, someone is going to have to replace him at some point. But another thing about the cherries is what doesn't biodegrade into the ground actually grows and becomes new cherry trees. I saw people in the youth group. I saw young people that are going to go out into the world and grow into large cherry trees in other places, other communities, and become the Eagle's Way in those places. You know, I saw the future of a church a couple weeks ago, and it's something I'm really, really excited about. And that's a testament to you as parents. It's a testament to you as aunts, uncles, family, friends, because it really does take a village to really lead these children in the right way. And I just want to commend you all for making my job easy in dealing with them, because they're getting so many great things at home. So I just want to just take a second, just give yourselves just a round of applause for the great job that you're doing. If you're a first-time visitor or visiting with us, and even remember, if you haven't filled out a connection card, fill that out and drop it in the offering bucket. On the back, we have some questions for you guys to fill out and let us know some information about you, some things you might want to be interested in. We'll be getting in contact with what the connection cards are for. And without further ado, I'll turn it over to the band, and welcome to the cherry tree.
Let's stand and worship. Trust Jesus, and you are my God, and you are enough, Jesus. I give you my life, I give you my trust. Jesus, oh Jesus. Take it all, take it all, put my life in your hands. I lay down my life, I take up my cross, Jesus. For you are my God, whatever the cost, Jesus.
Surrender, God, that you just pour over us.
Thank you.
All of your love, and God, it's like a consuming fire, God.
Yes.
And we just are so, so thankful for that this morning.
Draw me closer to where you are. reach up and cross. I stand abandoned in your presence and embrace. And I'll never be the same, oh God. Your love is like fire, burns for all to see. My
given us strength through each and every moment, God. We love you and we praise you, God.
Says, but now God has shown us a way to be made right with him without keeping the requirements of the law, as was promised in the writings of Moses and the prophets long ago. We are made right with God by placing our faith in Jesus Christ. And this is true for everyone who believes, no matter who we are. For everyone has sinned, we have all fallen short of God's glorious standard, yet God freely and graciously declares that you are righteous. Aren't you thankful that 2,000 years ago, God looked into this day, into your lives, and knew that we would fall short, and knew that we would fail ourselves and fail each other, but yet he says, you are righteous. That he did that. I'm so thankful this morning for his body. We're going to receive communion later to the end of the service. And just as you do and throughout this whole service, just meditate on what he's done and who you are in him because of his body, because of his blood, because of his goodness, because of his mercy. And Father, we thank you. We thank you, Lord. Fed us
body and the blood of your son while we were sinners and unworthy of the mercy you've shown. Thank you for saving us, for saving us. Thank you for saving us, for saving us.
Emotional that I've ever gotten. I had fun rafting with my grandfather. I never knew that he was that fun. One of the things that I loved is that I actually got to be there with God. I felt God in the presence. He was right there, right beside me through emotional times. And I broke down a couple of walls, and it was one of my favorite things.
Breaking down and started actually listening. made everyone cry, and the service when they did it was really, really good, and everyone just really connected with God.
Trip was amazing. It was definitely one of the most impactful youth trips I've ever been on. And the kids, I'm so proud of the kids. They weren't scared to open up, and they weren't embarrassed to praise or like lift their hands up or cry. We just had the best worship services ever at the end of each day. I learned a lot from Brian and about Brian, about how good of a leader he is and can be and will be in the future. Tim was really good with the kids too, and I'm really excited for his future in the church, and I'm excited to see more of these kids and what they can do. They definitely surprised me in how awesome they can be and how positive they can be, so I had a great time.
Seeing the kids connect with the messages, with Brian talking the first night and Pastor Bieran and ending with Pastor Will the final night, it was incredible. And Bobby Joe's morning services, we were all tired, but we all went and enjoyed it. And I love the way the kids connected. They broke down lots of walls emotionally, and that was really good.
Sure, I went sitting on snakes, and I was taking the milk back to Bieran and Will's cabin because they had a refrigerator. And I hear, and I'm like, what is that? And then I hear something shuffle in the bushes. And so I kind of do this sweep of my light, and there's two guys, and they're standing like this with their back to me. And I was like, not cool. So I kept walking a little faster, and I got to the cabin. I was thinking, maybe I should ask them to walk me back, but I didn't, because I was like, I don't want to bother them. So I get back to walking, and all of a sudden I hear somebody running up behind me. And I turn around, and I shine the light, and there's this dude, and he's in a clown mask, and like, rah! And I was like, why would you do that? And he dropped his hands, and he walked away. I go back to camp, I'm telling the guys about it. Next thing I know, Brian and Tim come back up to me, and they're like, we took care of that. I was like, what, took care of what? He was like, we took care of that guy. We don't have to worry about him scaring nobody else no more. And I just thought that was really cool, that even a situation that my friends, our group, had my back. And that meant a lot to me, more so than anything, because they supported me and protected me, and they were going to make sure that we were cool. And everybody in the whole camp, in our camp group, seemed to do that. Another thing that was great was seeing their vulnerability, seeing them tear those walls down and, you know, receive the Holy Spirit and receive anointing and receive words from the Lord.
Ah! Ah! ushers are preparing to receive our morning's tithes and offerings. Normally we do the offering at the end, but we got a couple other things we need to do at the end this morning. So you may or may not have had an opportunity to fill out your connection card. You can do that right now at this moment as that offering, and you don't have to pass that bucket until it gets by. There are a few things that are coming up. We have in August, we have a family night, bowling night planned. And if you'd like to be a part of that, it's $10 per person. That $10 includes all of your bowling, your shoes, your pizza, and your Coke. So if you want to sign up for that, you can do that. We will have plenty of lanes, put everybody together. If you have a certain number of folks you're signing up for, you can put that on the connection card also. And for those of you that are already planned and prepared for the new member lunch that is today, it will be right after the service in the youth building. Go right out these front doors, up the concrete steps to the third building at the top, and lunch will be there for you. We'll give you some more information about membership here at Eagles Way. We have another one of those planned in November, the first Sunday in November. So if you are interested in knowing more about membership at Eagles Way, that'll be a great class for you. Let's pray and bless this offering. Father, Lord, we thank you, Lord, that we can come to your house. Lord, that we can worship you, that we can be encouraged. That, Lord, you are for all ages. From the little ones that are in the nursery, Lord, we ask you to bless them this morning. And every hands, Father, Lord, that are touching their lives and taking care of them and meeting their needs, bless them, God. Lord, all the way, Father, Lord, to us here in the service today, that you will continue, Father, Lord, as we open ourselves to you, that you pour into us. Thank you, Lord, that you'll take these tithes, these offerings, these alms. Lord, they'll use them for the betterment of your kingdom. This house, in this community, and in this world. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Good morning. Joey, you did an awesome job last week, but you got to get your water. Can't leave your water up here. So always get your water. There you go. Don't drink it. It's like leaving water in the car too long if you leave it up here too long. How's everybody? Good. You ought to be good. You're in the house of the Lord. That's something to be good about. We're going to talk to you this morning. I'm gonna do something real quick. So if you fill in your notes, if you don't, that's fine. Sometimes we have them on the back of the bulletin. Sometimes we don't. But if you want to fill it in right quick, I want to give it to you real quick what those four points are. We've been talking about relational wholeness this summer, and we've had up right now seven different speakers that have talked about it. Got one more coming next week. And we talked about communication in relationships. We talked about being a priest in your relationships. We talked about being a friend in your relationships. We talked about communication in your relationships. Talked about relationship with your finances. So I thought, wow, we talked about relationships with a husband and wife. And I thought this week, man, we've really covered a lot of great relationships. Talked about relationships with authority. But I thought, you know, it might be time to talk about a relationship with God. I mean, that's a pretty serious relationship, don't you think? So we're going to talk about a relationship with God this morning through faith. And I'm going to give you some points that I believe is some of the most important things I've ever seen in all my years of ministry about faith. Now, here's your outline. We're going to talk about the privilege of faith, the promise of faith, the purpose of faith, and the persistence of faith. Faith is important because the Bible says, without faith it's impossible to please God, and he that cometh to God must believe he is God. He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Faith is important because the Bible says without faith it's impossible to please him. Faith is important because the Bible says by grace are you saved through faith. And that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God. Say faith is a gift of God. This is important because as we go through this, you have to realize that you have the same amount of faith as anybody on the face of the earth. Faith is a gift of God. The Bible says faith is important because the Bible says, I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ lives within me. And the life I now live, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Faith is important because the Bible says the just shall live by faith. Faith is important because the Bible says that we walk by faith. Faith is important because the Bible says that there's only three things that's going to remain forever, and that is faith and hope and love. And the greatest of these is love. So how many would say today that the most important thing and aspect of your life is faith? You came to know Christ by faith. You came to know your relationship with God by faith. And so in 2 Peter, and this I'm not going to get in all the details about this book, but this book is so important. Even though it's three chapters, it's a very small book. This book almost didn't make it into the canon. It almost didn't. It was one of the last books that finally made it in because of the way Peter wrote this, that they thought this just didn't sound like Peter. This was a little bit too strong. It was a little bit too in your face. It was just a little bit, maybe just stronger than they would have thought Peter would have written at this particular time in his life. But Peter is on a mission to make sure that before he leaves this planet, and Peter was the man who said it at the end of his life when they came to crucify Peter. Peter said, "Crucify me upside down, for I'm not worthy to be crucified as my Lord." And they literally crucified Peter upside down. How many know that we have a tremendous heritage of faith? Not only the faith of Christ, not only the faith of the Old Testament prophets, but the faith of men and women who literally gave their life so that you could sit here on Sunday morning and worship God and sing praises to Him and hear God's word. They literally gave their life for that. And so Peter begins and he says, "This letter is from Simon Peter, a slave and apostle of Jesus Christ. I'm writing to you who share the same precious faith we have." Now, I want you to just dwell on that for a moment, because this is what this first point is all about. I'm writing to you who share the same precious faith we have. The faith was given to you because of the justice and the fairness of Jesus Christ, our God and Savior. May God give you more and more grace and peace as you grow in the knowledge of God and of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Wow. Now, let me give you the background of this letter. This letter wasn't written to the Jewish people. This letter was written to the people of Cornelius' house. This letter was written to the Gentiles who, by the same faith as the Jew, were grafted in to the family of God. As Peter was up on a rooftop one day, and he was going to be eating soon, and he fell into a trance. The Bible says that a vision happened, and two things were going on. There was a man named Cornelius way over here, and he was a Gentile, but he loved God. And the Bible says that what he did went up to as a memorial to God, because he loved God and he loved people so much that he gave alms, that his prayers and his giving went up as a memorial before God. Aren't you glad that your prayers and your giving, the things that you do, always go up as a memorial before God? You see, we think sometimes nothing's happening. We may think sometimes, is anything really going to come out of this? Is anything really going to come out of my relationship with God? Well, the Bible says that these prayers and his almsgiving went up as a memorial to God. And so God takes Peter up on a roof. He falls into a trance. He has a vision. And in this vision, there's this sheet that comes down. And on this sheet, there's all manner of four-footed beasts. And this voice comes to Peter and says, "Rise, kill, and eat." And Peter says, "No, Lord, I've never ate anything. I'm of the Jewish faith, and we don't eat certain things." And Jesus, God, and Peter are in this conversation because Peter's eyes are about to be opened to something that's going to revolutionize Christianity. And God does it again, and he does it three times. And finally, God speaks to Peter, and he says these words, "What I have cleansed, don't you call common." And it wasn't long after that, a knock on the door came, And some men had come from Cornelius' house, and Peter ends up going to the Gentiles' house and finds out that the same faith that God had given them was the same faith that God was going to give to the Gentiles. Now here's the faith that he gave it. He gave a faith called precious faith. Precious faith is that, listen, this is so, if you don't get anything else, get this. I'm telling you, if you don't get anything else, get this. This is the same faith that was equal in honor and privilege as Peter's. It was the same faith that Peter had when the Lord came walking on the water, and Peter said, "Lord, if that's you, bid me to come." And he got out of the water boat, and he walked on water. It's the same faith that Peter had that you have. Because of what? The justice and the fairness of God. See, some people say, "Oh, I wish I had the faith of so-and-so." You do. It's a gift. It's not something you work for. Faith is a gift. And so he says, you have this faith. I love to see people operate in faith. I love to see people who are just crazy in faith. Barbara had a situation this week. Her had an abscessed tooth, and her jaw swells out to here, and she's really in a lot of pain. It was taken care of. But before it was taken care of, she was in Walmart, and a lady come up to her, and they were in conversation, and this lady's faith just arose, and she said, "Let me just pray for you right now." And she just laid her hands on Barbara right there in Walmart and began to pray for God to heal her jaw. Okay. Don't you love that? Don't you? It was Elaine Holloway. Elaine Holloway is full of faith. And you are too. She just has the audacity to do it. She just has the audacity to use her faith in wherever she is. I remember being in a post office years ago, and this little old lady comes up to me, and she's about this high. And she comes up to me, and she says, "You're Pastor Buren, aren't you?" And I said, "Yeah." She said, "I know." She said, "Me and two other ladies meet every Monday night, and we pray for you." Now, I took that one of two ways. I'm really special, or these people know I need it. And I think what it was that she knew and they knew, and I said, "You meet every Monday night?" "Every Monday night, me and two other ladies." She said, "We only pray for you." It's pretty amazing. And then she says, "As a matter of fact, I want to pray for you right now." I went, "Right now?" She said, "Yeah." And so she reaches in her pocketbook. She pulls out a bottle of oil, puts it on. She says, "I like to really lay the oil on when I pray for people." I said, "Okay." So she lays her hands on my head, and I'm praying. This is the shortest prayer in the history of mankind. But it wasn't. It was not a short prayer. It was at least a good 5-minute prayer. But you know what? She was just using her faith. She was just using her faith. You see, there's two kinds. It says we get this faith, and we'll get more of this faith and more of this grace and more of this knowledge, more of this peace because of the knowledge of God. There's two Greek words for knowledge. There's gnosis, which is knowledge about God. And there's epinosis, which is intimate, personal knowledge about God. And he says, in this epinosis knowledge, O King James says, grace and mercy will be multiplied to you. I have gnosis knowledge of the piano. I love to hear Kitty play. I benefit from, I'm stirred. I have had, over the years of her playing, moments of laughter, moments of tears, moments of inspiration, reflection, deep, deep movements of God. But it's all because I have a knowledge about it. But Kitty has an epinosis. And if you could be inside her being when she's playing sometimes, what you feel doesn't even come close to what she feels. My granddaughter's 10 years old and becoming a very good piano player because she's got a very good teacher. But at 10 years old, I forget just the words she told her mother. She said, what'd she say, that when I'm playing the piano, you remember? That's when I'm, anyway, she was saying, that's when something happens inside me every time I play the piano. That's because she has an epinosis knowledge of it. God didn't save you just to take you to heaven. God, thank God that if I die today, I'm in heaven. But he didn't save you to take you to heaven. He saved you for heaven to come to earth. See, in Revelation 21, the New Jerusalem's coming down out of heaven, and the church has had it backwards for so many years. We're trying to get to heaven, and God's trying to get heaven on earth. God's trying to get heaven here. How many know you need heaven here? Do you need God more now when you die? Come on. Come on. When you die, you're going to be all right. All's going to be fine. I need him now. I need to operate my faith now. And you have this faith that God's given you. The same precious faith that was in Peter is in you. All you got to do is do the same thing Peter said one day. Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father in heaven. Thou art Peter, you are the Petros, you are a piece of the rock, and upon this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. And ever since that statement, for almost 2,000 years, or at least for 1,500 years, there's been a battle over that rock, and who is the rock? The Catholic Church says it's Peter, and the Protestant Church says it's Christ. Well, it's both. It's both. It's the Christ, the Petros, and it's the Petros that you are. You are a piece of the rock, and he's building his church upon that. And the gates of hell cannot prevail against it. Amen. I want to say, I've got the same faith that Peter had. I got the same faith. Same faith. So next time an obstacle comes your way, or situations come your way, it's okay to ask somebody to pray for you. That's fine and that's good. But say to yourself, I have the same faith as Peter. The same faith that gave a man such an aura of God that when he walked by people in the city, his shadow passed them and they were healed. They were healed. You see, we read that in the book of Acts and we go, oh, that was Peter. Let me tell you something. You will never know the people that you have walked by and your aura touched their life and healed them. You'll never know. You'll never know just by your presence what's happening in an individual's life because of the aura of God that's coming and emanating from you because you are of God. Because you don't see it doesn't mean it's never happened. Because you don't know it doesn't mean it never transpired or it never took place. If every believer would walk out of church today and walked into their automobile and go to their homes and get up in the morning and go to their place of employment and walk in there like they're Peter, walk in there knowing and realizing the same faith that was in Peter is in me. Same faith. Same God. Same Lord. Same Spirit. And see, that's why the enemy has wanted to, so many years, divide the church, divide people, divide families, and keep people at war with each other because they don't know who they are. There's one God, one faith, one baptism, one Lord, in all, through all, of all. The promise of faith. By divine power, God has given us everything we need for living a godly life. We have received all of this by coming to know him, the one who called us to himself, by means of his marvelous glory and excellence. And because of his glory and excellence, he has given us great and precious promises. And these are the promises that enable you to share his divine nature and escape the world's corruption caused by human desires. The promise of faith is you have his divine nature. We have God's nature in us. We have His divine nature. Two aspects of the promise. You have His divine nature, so you can escape. In other words, I've given you the ability. Not like the comedian says, I had the right to remain silent, but I didn't have the ability. God's given you the ability through the power of the Holy Spirit to succeed. That's the promise. I need more of God. No, no. You need more of knowledge that already what you have. You can't get no more of God. God can't get any more inside you than He's inside you. Understand? You just have to increase in the knowledge of who He is. And the more knowledge I come to understand, then that's all I need to know. And so I got the privilege of faith. I got the same faith as Peter's got. I got the promise of faith. I've got the same divine nature as Christ. I know. You look at your wife, your husband, or your kids sometimes, and you don't see it. Believe it or not, there are times Barbara does not see the divine nature of Almighty God in Pastor Buren. There are fleeting moments where that divine nature is not shining through, but that divine nature is still there. The divine nature is still that, whether you see it or not, it's there. It's there. They just have to become again aware of it. It'd be neat that every now and then, whoa, calm down. That's not the nature that you really are. There's another nature. Won't you let that nature come through right now? There's another nature in you. This one's, you're getting confused. Your schizophrenic's jumping in right now. I know that's who you used to be, but that's not who you are. Just remind them, that's not them. Now, make sure you do that in a sweet, gentle way. Because if you don't, you will see more of that other nature. And it will get meaner and meaner. And meaner. So, but just, you know, that's not you. So when you see your mate or someone not having, showing that divine nature, don't let that fool you. They're masquerading. That's not them. And we just have to be aware of who we are. That's who we are. I am who God says I am. I've said it several times, but when you take off your blouse or you take off your t-shirt and you look at the back of the label, and there's a label back there and it says made by so and so, there's only one person, two people who have the right to put that label in your shirt, and that's the people who created it, or it's the people who bought it. And God created you and He bought you. He's the only one able and willing and has the right to say who you are. Is the purpose of faith. In view of all this, make every effort to respond to God's promises. Supplement your faith with a generous provision of moral excellence, and moral excellence with knowledge. And knowledge, self-control. And self-control, patience, endurance. And patient endurance with godliness. And godliness with brotherly affection. And brotherly affection with love for everyone. The more you grow like this, the more productive and useful you will be in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. The more you grow like this, the reason that I have this, the purpose of my faith, is that so I can be useful and effective in the kingdom of God. Useful and effective. You know, it was at youth camp, you didn't get to see the real inner workings of it, but when you see kids, 12, 13 year olds, got the same faith as Peter's got. And their prayers is just as powerful and just as important as anybody else's prayers. Matter of fact, if a kid wants to pray for you, fall down on your knees and let them pray for you. They will pray the best prayer you've ever had prayed over you. have the same faith and hadn't been warped through the years by other people. It's real genuine faith. I picked up Anna at school a couple of years ago, and I was going home, and she was in the back seat, and she said, "My stomach hurts. It hurts." I said, "I'm sorry." She said, "Pray." She didn't care about it. She didn't want my sympathy. She wanted my prayers. Pray. That's, you know, if we would just rise up more, "Oh, I'm sorry," pray. Wow, what a strange idea. Use our faith and pray about something. I want you to see this a ladder here, and I want to show you something. Theologians, a lot of people call this the virtue ladder. I want to call this the ladder of elevation. Do I have the ladder? It's the ladder. Here it goes. Now, we couldn't quite get the ladder up there. We tried. But I want you to vision this as a ladder, okay? And the first rung of the ladder is faith. You step up on faith because that's where it all begins. You begin with faith. And the next rung of the ladder is excellence. And excellence is just taking it and making it effective in every area of my life. It's just making it better. Now, there are certain things you probably won't be able to make better in your life. If you can't sing, you can't sing. Now, it may, in the shower, we all sound like we can sing. But there's something about the acoustics in the shower that makes everybody Garth Brooks. I mean, I sound just like Garth in the shower. Just like him. You would think I'm on the stage singing Garth Brooks song because I sound just like him. But the water's hitting down and the echo, and it's just perfect. But there are things in my life I can get better at. Because of faith, I can excel in moral character. I can be a good individual. And there's not a person on the face of the earth that can't be a better person because of faith. Because I exercise my faith, I'm a better person. I don't know if you ever noticed, but if somebody gets born again, they become a better person. Anybody ever notice that? Well, if they're not better, it didn't happen. Okay. So excellence, and then to excellence add knowledge. That's why you're here this morning. That's why I'm here this morning. Get a little more knowledge of God, right? Add self-control. Self-control, the Bible says that he that controls his own spirit is better than the person who takes a city. You'd be amazed at what would happen if in a moment you're about to say something and you use self-control. You'd be amazed how better you're going to feel 5 minutes later that you use self-control. You see, we want self-control over what we consider some really huge, big things, but you know what? It's really all small things. It's really just hitting the delete button on the computer. Pretty easy. It's really just changing the channel. It's pretty easy. Just a moment of self-control. You'll be amazed what would happen if I just, because you think it, don't mean you got to say it. You know, there's almost this thing that people brag about people when they go, "I like them because whatever they think, they say it." Really? That person really gets the compliment, "I love them because they just speak their mind." Really? Most of the time, I don't really care for what they speak. Most of the time, I really wish they had just not spoken their mind. How many know the world would be much better off if we all just didn't speak our minds at times? What kind of self-control would it be? Wow. Patience. And patience is, some people say patience. The word for patience is really perseverance. See, you'll never get to the place where it just don't bother me. I can just sit here forever. You know, some people get the idea that's what patience is. Patience is I put up with you and you put up with me. It's tolerance sometimes. I tolerate you. You tolerate me. If you've been married more than 5 minutes, you tolerated each other for some period of time. You've got to tolerate one another. And so this perseverance, then he says, and add to that godliness. And look, let me show you what godliness is. Okay? You want to be like God? Hey, Joe, how are you? Good to see you, man. You really look good. That's a godly word. Man, let me just encourage you and bless you. I love you. Thank God for you. Being kind to somebody, that's all godliness is. It's not raising the dead. It's just being nice. And then he says, affection. Just be affectionate. Just be affectionate. What will happen? I'll enter into a realm called love. This love says it's love for everyone. Problem with the church and with people at times. We're told to love each other, to go love, but we try to start with love. Kitty's coming. You can't start with love. You don't have the ability to do that until you've exercised faith. You let faith add some moral character to your life. You let some knowledge come, self-control, patience, godliness, and affection. And then you reach this pinnacle of love. But you don't start there. Aristotle said there are three theories to the source of happiness. I want to see which one you think is real. It comes by training, learning, and formation of good habits. It's a divine allotment or a gift. God just bestows it upon you. It's a matter of chance. Most people live their life expecting God to make them happy. And it's just a gift of God, a divine allotment that's going to happen in their life. Or they think it's just a matter of chance. It may happen, it may not happen. We have this theory. I pulled uptown the other week and I was in Barbara's Jeep, which y'all know is really my Jeep, but she gets to drive it. And it's a nice automobile. Somebody else pulls up and it's no air conditioned in the vehicle. It's pretty bad shape. And they walk up to me and says, you know, God's just been so good to you. And you have those moments. A man came to Ralph a few weeks ago. He came up through school with. He's a drug addict. Ralph was able to minister to him and got him in rehab. And man's just big change in his life. But he told Ralph, said, God's just really been good to you. God's just really been good to you. God is good to everybody. God is good to everybody. God's given everybody the allotment of faith. He's given you the faith to use it however you want to use it. Don't be ashamed of the blessings and the favor of God that rest upon your life because you've been persistent in loving God and loving people. And I was sweet to the person, but I let them know. He loves you too. He wants the same thing for me as for you. The same faith as in Peter, it's in you. And you can function that way. You see, the fact of the matter is, happiness comes by training, learning, and the formation of good habits. not going to drop down out of heaven in the gift of God, divine allotment, bam. It's not going to be a matter of chance. It's a matter of choices. The persistence of faith. Peter says those who fail to climb this ladder, they become short-sighted, they become blind, and they are forgetting they've been cleansed. So, dear brothers and sisters, work hard to prove you really are among those God has called and chosen. Do these things and you will never fall away. Then God will give you a grand entrance into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He's not talking about heaven there, he's talking about it here. Therefore, I will always remind you about these things. Even though you already know them and are standing firm in the truth you've been taught, it is only right that I should keep on, listen, reminding you as long as I live. For our Lord Jesus Christ has shown me that I must soon leave this earthly life. So I'll work hard to make sure you always remember these things after I'm gone. I brought you purposely to a sober moment, because what I'm about to read is tough. What I'm about to read to you and share with you, I'll be honest with you, it's tough. 10 virgins. Jesus tells a parable. They have the same lamp, the same amount of oil. But while the bridegroom's away, the oil begins to be used up. So when the cry of the bridegroom comes, that the bridegroom is ready, all 10 virgins rise up. They trim their lamps and they light them, and they start to head toward the bridegroom, and 5 of the 10 virgins' lamps begin to go out. And they looked at the other 5 virgins and said to them, "Give us of your oil." They said, "We can't do that. We won't have enough." You see, there's some places and things in life that we come to, it's too late to purchase the oil. It's too late. And it's not just one thing can happen. It's happened in my life over many times. I wasn't prepared for a moment, for a situation that had my oil in my lamp the way I should have had. Had I been persistent in the things of God I should have been persistent in. Had I loved God, had I loved my brothers and sisters, had I prayed, had I just been prepared, had I been aware of who I am, had I been aware of the faith that's in me, then when I got to a circumstance or a situation that I was all of a sudden encountered with a decision and a choice I had to make, had I been ready for that, then I could have made the proper choice and I could have overcome a circumstance and a situation and been much better off had I been ready for the moment. Got football season coming up. I love them, loving them, getting all riled up about the University of Georgia. But I'm going to tell you something, those boys are getting ready now. Because if they're not, when kickoff happens, too late. Can't go to the weight room when you're on the field. You can't look at the playbook. You can't get conditioned once the ball's been kicked. You better be ready. And I love you enough to, and I was sharing with Brother Raffles, I said, I'm going to have to be a little daddy today. I'm going to be a little pastoral if that's okay. Every now and then, you know, that's what we do. Some of you are not exercising the faith that God's given you, and you need to exercise the faith and be aware of who you are. Because there's going to be a moment in life you're going to come to, and you're not going to be ready. And you're going to wish 1,000 times, God, I wish I'd have been ready for that moment. I wish I'd have been filled with the Holy Spirit at that moment so I could have used some self-control and went, whoa, back up. Don't say something you're going to regret for days and weeks and maybe regret the rest of your life. You don't know. There's another parable, and I never liked the parable. Someone didn't have on the gown, and he said, why didn't you put it on your wedding gown? because they didn't have it on, they didn't get to go in. And I thought, that's bad. No, it wasn't bad because they were given the gown. It was provided them. God's given the same provision to you as He has for anybody else. And I know that's kind of tough. It is tough. You see, Jesus is the kind, though, that he one time he'd say, I love you, love you, love you. Another time he just said, let me tell you something. This scripture, wow. I'm given some talents. Come to one and said, what'd you do with yours? Well, I doubled it. What'd you do with your talents? I doubled it. Wow. What'd you do with yours? I knew what kind of man you was. I just dug it, hid it in the ground. In other words, I didn't do anything with it. Well, I love the story you told last week about the guy who brought the pot. He was honest. Didn't pull no pun. He tried, but he worked. He labored. At the end of that parable, Jesus says, and to those who use well what they're given, even more will be given. But from those who do nothing, even what little they have will be taken away. I don't like to preach that. That's tough. Because what he's saying is, if he gives Joe the same talents he gives me, and Joe goes and uses his and develops them and doubles them, and the bridegroom comes at any period of time in life to call upon that gift. But see, he's not talking about the second coming of Christ. He's calling the times in your life when God's going to come to you in a moment and have to pull out that gift that you have. I need this gift of mercy right now. He's going to come at a time when unexpectedly, I need your mercy into this person, in this circumstance, in that situation. I need that. You see, I believe everything I have is God's. I got 3 automobiles, but 2 of them's out on loan. I don't need but one. You don't know. God, what you have, somebody may come at a time, I need that. And I want to be ready. Because if I don't use mine, then God's going to come and take mine, and He's going to give it to Joe, who already has more. But because He did something with what He's got, He says, I'm going to take from you, Bird, and give it to Joe. I got to give it to somebody who's going to use it for the kingdom of God's sake. You don't know. When you walk out this door, you don't know Monday morning, that person you're going to come in contact with, they're going to need to pull on that gift that God has bestowed in you. The gift of faith, the gift of love, the gift of just being kind and godly, and patient, and persevering with them. And God's going to just call on that any moment. Wow. See, He didn't give it to me to hoard up. He gave it to me to give out. He really did. He really did. You need my car to go home? Take it home. I get a ride with somebody else. I'm trying to just make a point. I'm not bragging about doing a good deed. I'm trying to make a point. God gives you things and gifts so that He can call upon them at any moment. Somebody's going to need that. Somebody's going to need that word, that patience, that mercy. It's going to happen. And I want to encourage you, what are you doing with the faith that God has given you? What are you doing with the gifts that God has given you? What are you doing with them? What are you doing with them? Didn't pour them in only so they could be poured out. He makes you, blesses you so you be a blessing. That's the whole purpose. Whole purpose. And we got too many people at Eagles Way Church who are sitting on their faith. And not exercising it, but letting God use them to do some awesome, mighty things. Awesome, mighty things. You've got the same faith. Same Holy Spirit. Same gifts. And I got to use them. I decided a long time ago, I don't know how many more years I have, but I decided a long time ago I'm going out in the blaze of glory. I'm not going out limping. I want to use my gifts that God's given me to the best of my ability all the days of my life to do whatever He wants me to do at any given time in my life. And that's all God asks for anybody. As we come to receive communion today, I want to be truly that remembrance time. I know we've been lengthy this morning, but when I get to these moments, I don't care about time. We got to do what we got to do. But when your eldership's coming, we come to receive communion, remember the price of the faith that was paid. Would you do that? Remember the price so that I can activate my faith to a greater dimension than ever before. Sixth graders with you that's graduating, going up. If they would all come and just stand in front of me, all the sixth graders that's going up to the youth today, they'll be coming down. And then what I want after all the sixth graders get here, y'all just stand right here in front of me. Would you do that? Just stand face me. Yeah, just stand right here. Then all the other kids, I know you're starting school tomorrow. So is this all the sixth graders going up? Okay. All the rest of you kids that start back school tomorrow, would you just come down and stand in the back of them? Some of you don't start tomorrow, but you start sometime. But all of you come down, because you're going to start. And just Pastor Beard wants to have communion with you. And we're going to give some Bibles out to those in the six going to the next level. But, all right. I want you to all look at me, okay? I wonder where everybody was. All of y'all was all the people's in church, children's church. Okay, look at me. You ready? All right. Start back school tomorrow. Some of you a little bit later on. How many's found out that at school everybody don't act right? How many found out that some people, even me, they just, and they even say things about people they shouldn't say things about? You know what? That hurts. That really hurts. What I want you to do when you start back school, I want you to go with this in mind. I'm going to be different. I'm not going to be like other people. Just because they say this and they do that, I'm not going to be that way. I'm going to be different. I'm going to be a shining light. Because the Bible says you're the light of the world. And you're the salt of the earth. In other words, you light the way for other people. And see, sometimes the pressure comes that they want to make you like them. But if you'll continue to let your light shine, you know what? You'll make them like you. Because light is brighter than darkness. Light always overshadows and never comes darkness. So, when you're at school, I want you to take this bread, I want you to break it. When you do, I want you to remember that Jesus gave his life so that we could have life. Jesus paved the way for us. I know some of you have talked about me, and you've said, I wish Pastor Beard would get some bread that tastes better than that. How many of you have said that about me? I wish they'd get some bread that was better than that. Let me tell you why we give you this dry styrofoam. It's to remind you of the pain and the suffering that Christ went through to bring us all the good stuff. Okay? So remember that when you're in school, maybe you'll be betrayed. Somebody's going to say something about you. It's not true. They're going to try to defame you or make you seem like somebody you're not. Jesus said this was his blood shed for the remission of our sins. As we drink this, remember, when we're talked about, just forgive them. I'm excited about, we're going to give these Bibles to these sixth graders. Holly, call their name out. This is a huge step. Translations that I've gone through and used over the years. This is the best translation I've ever seen. You can understand everything in that book. You really can't. You read it, you'll understand it. You'd be amazed. I encourage you to start in the New Testament, okay? To start in Matthew and just read through the New Testament this school year. How many will commit to do that with me? Just read through the New Testament this year. God, fill them with the power of your Holy Spirit. Let them know that they're loved by you. Let them know, God, that they're the light of the world and they're the salt of the earth. And I pray that as they walk down the halls, that the aura of God's going to come from them, and that there'll be other boys' and girls' lives changed because of who they are and what they do. And so we send them forth, Lord, into this new school year with your blessings, with your strength, your power, your grace, your faith. And may they be aware, God, every single day they arise, may they be aware that they're God's kids coming to know you in a greater and more powerful way. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Everybody said amen. You know what amen means? Let it be. Let it be. You say amen not because it's the end of the prayer. Let it be. So let this be in you, okay? All right. God bless you. God bless you. Glad y'all came too.